Reports predict that we'll be losing almost 50% of American jobs over the next 20 years, not to China or India, but to robots. Today, we look back 200 years to the Luddites for some insights into our future, ahead on Wide Angle. Although we like to think of ourselves as indispensable, recent economic analyses warn that fully 47% of U.S. jobs today will be automated over the next two decades. That includes jobs in manufacturing, already witnessed a significant displacement by automation, as well as newer sectors, drivers of all sorts, cabs, tractor trailers, even 747s, insurance underwriters, library technicians, journalists, and some in the medical and legal fields. The workers of Northern Britain at the turn of the 19th century experienced a similar displacement by the technology of the day. And you've likely heard of a particularly assertive segment of them, the Luddites. Hailing from the same region as Robin Hood and his merry band of wealth redistributors, the Luddites sought to protect workers like themselves from the excesses of the owning class. Joining me from his home in New York to discuss the Luddites, their times, and the lessons they might offer us today is Clive Thompson. Clive is the author of the book, Smarter Than You Think, How Technology is Changing Our Minds for the Better. And for the past 20 years has been a journalist writing on the impact of technology on politics, culture, and everything in between for periodicals such as the New York Times Magazine and Mother Jones. He also writes for Smithsonian, which published in their January-February edition his article, Rage Against the Machines, which provides the basis for our conversation today. Welcome to Wide Angle, Clive.
Good to be here.
Thanks for joining me. I should say that probably the place to start here is going back 200 years, yeah, to the Luddites, to Northern Britain. The Industrial Revolution has started in England, but it really hasn't seeped up to the textile region of Northern Britain, where the Luddites are, yeah?
Right.
So if you could paint us a picture of the textile industry, of the pace of life in that place at that time, right around 1800.
Sure, yeah. Well, what you had was a lifestyle for the textile workers that was actually fairly pleasant. They had a lot of autonomy. The work was done in the home. And so you would have a whole family working on something. You know, if someone was a weaver, you might have his wife and children, helping with the work and spinning wool that the weavers and weaving on these frames. If you're a cropper, that means you're someone who uses these tools that are in the home to take a big piece of wool and sort of smooth the top of it. And this work, you know, they could decide when they would work. They could decide how many hours to work and what days not to work. So they had a lot of autonomy. The amount of money that you made was also quite stable, which is to say it was peaceful work, but you knew if you did X amount of pieces how much you were going to get paid. It was a fairly pleasant lifestyle, and you know, this is reflected in diaries of the time when you read and they talk about what their lives were like. And it had been that way. It was also, I should point out, it had been very stable for quite a long time. So all the sort of rules around how long you had to apprentice before you became a cropper, before you became a master weaver, 7 years apprenticeship, this stuff had all been formalized for decades and decades and decades. So pleasant life, very stable for a long time.
Okay. And the first decade of that new century ushers in some significant changes for the people up in the Luddite Triangle, yeah? So war with Napoleon had halted trade, had driven up prices for food, for everyday goods, you wrote. Men had started wearing trousers, which in our day and age, of course, okay. But lessening the demand, which was sizable back then, for stockings,
Yeah, exactly.
And those changes conspire to encourage the owners of these businesses to lower costs, yeah? Which
had an
immediate impact on the life that you just painted a picture of. How did the owners try to lower costs, operating costs?
Well, there was a couple things. One is obviously they said, well, we are going to pay less for this work. But they also wanted to work more efficiently. And so they began to bring in more and more sophisticated machinery. That included things like these much larger frames that would allow someone to very rapidly make a very large piece of cloth. Mm-hmm. And instead of sort of stitching a stocking very meticulously, you know, going around in circles up the leg, you just take a great big piece of cloth, cut it up, and sort of fold it over into a stocking. They were called cut-ups. They were much cheaper, the stockings. They weren't very good. They fell apart. So, but one person could now produce like six times as many stockings. Right. And they also began to automate. They began to put together factories and said, well, look, we can create some machines that will, you know, some looms and some machines and some weaving machineries that will move more quickly. They will all be powered by one central power source, a great big, you know, coal-burning engine. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to need workers to not work from home, but to come in and, mm-hmm. and tend to these machines in this actually kind of ghastly environment.
All right. So very quickly, within the course of a decade, really, poverty in the Luddite Triangle, as Kirkpatrick Sale calls it, goes up. Wages come down, as you remark, for those who still have a job, right? And certainly there were people who were displaced from the job market entirely, at least that job market.
Entirely, yeah. And autonomy goes down, because don't forget, you're not, you know, if you're going to work in a factory, now you are on the clock. You don't have the ability to set your hours the way you did before, and the loss of autonomy was a big thing.
Right.
So, and there was also, like, you know, because the merchants who own these industrials who own these businesses were cutting wages, there was also a rupture with, you know, decades of this idea of a fair profit. Mm-hmm. You know, there was this, you know, before the late 18th century, you have the idea that widespread amongst the textile workers that it was perfectly fair for the owner who was paying for all the goods to take a profit, but it should be a fair profit. Now, Adam Smith comes along with Wealth of Nations, of course, in the late 18th century, and his argument is, no, there's no moral right to any particular profit or sharing of profits. It's all efficiency and how much you can get from a better exploitation of labor and capital.
And in fact, there were, as you write it in this, your Smithsonian article, there were a number of negotiating points, really, that the Luddites brought to owners, right? So, 1811, unions aren't legalized in England until 1824, I think. They actually sort of set off on their own and become their attempt at a bargaining unit with owners. And certainly, as you say, they talk about this notion of sharing the profits, the fair profit idea that you speak to. They also suggested perhaps that a fund be created to be fueled by a tax on cloth, which was central to the project of textiles, of course.
That's right.
To support those who were unemployed by the coming machines.
Yeah, they thought that you should maybe, you know, they could see the machines coming. Like they weren't ignorant of the value of mechanization.
Yep.
They themselves had used, you know, different types of machines themselves in their work over the years.
Yep.
But they thought, well, okay, if there's going to be a disruptor here, you should do it very gradually over a decade or two, so that the people have time to adjust.
Certainly, be easy to come away from. I think just a quick read of the history to believe that the Luddites were upset with the machines. They were upset with mechanization, with industrialization, and to a certain extent, you know, rage against the machines, as Smithsonian labeled your article. It leads us a little bit astray, because I gather that they weren't really arguing with the machines. As you say, they had been working machines for some time. They were arguing about something deeper, yes? What was that something deeper that they were upset with?
They were arguing about what the moral nature of capitalism would become. They objected to the idea that the capitalists, people that are putting the money up for the enterprise, you know, that are paying for to acquire the sheeps that are going to be sheared to spin into wool and the frames that are going to be used for this. They thought that, you know, the labor ought to have some fair shake in any increased profits that come out of making that more efficient.
One of the things certainly that fascinates me about this story is that from the perspective of 21st century, we would look back at the Luddites, I imagine, as a group of relatively uneducated laborers, yes? But they made a compelling moral argument. Did the owners of the day pick up the deeper nature of their argument, or was it simply they were responding to the breaking of machines which they couldn't accept?
From the perspective of the of a factory owner or an industrialist or a mercantile shop person, if your actual stuff is being destroyed, you know, I think it's very easy to get your back up, basically.
Sure.
The point is this was a really interesting inflection point in how people that ran businesses thought of their responsibility to the world around them. And they were, as a letter writer at the time said, they were much influenced by the writings of Adam Smith. Yeah. And so they were really not at all interested in any of these schemes for taxing to provide funds for the displaced, the people displaced by machines. They were understandably, I think, interested in the idea that they could become much more efficient within a more increased use of machinery.
Let's fast forward a little bit to that, to sort of how it plays out, yeah? By the winter of 1812, you write, and I quote, barely a few days went by without another attack, and the Luddites were soon breaking at least 175 machines per month. Within months, they had destroyed probably 800, worth £25,000, equivalent to about $2 million today. One owner was even killed, yeah? 4 months after that factory owner is killed, Parliament passes a law that hands out the death penalty to anyone destroying or injuring any stocking or lace frame or other machines or engines used in the framework knitted manufactory. Surprising to me, of course, is that there's no mention in that law passed by Parliament about a death penalty being imposed for violence against a human, which presumably gave rise to the law, yes? And so my sense is that there was actually a deeper meaning from Parliament by the law. It wasn't simply hurting a person. It wasn't even probably breaking a machine, was it? They were sending a deeper message to the Luddites and anybody who in that day might be listening to their story. Yeah?
Yeah, absolutely. This was this law was very much a shot across the bow from the government to the Luddites that their ideas and all they were espousing was not going to stand. In many respects, this was really the beginning of the deep unification of the state with the with capital owners, with the merchants and the industrialists.
So the spoiler alert for viewers is that this story after 15 months does not end well for the Luddites. Yeah, as might be expected, there were, that you write in the article, 24 Luddites who were publicly hanged. 24 who were sent to prison, and another 51 who were shipped off to Australia. And rather effectively, the Luddite rebellion comes to an end. Yeah?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. It was a furiously quick burst of activity, but it fell apart because it turns out that, you know, once they really threw their might at it, I mean, the government sent about 14,000 soldiers into the north of England.
But it was a burst of activity, 15 months, and yet to us, 200 years away, they still reach out with their story, which you brought to us very, very eloquently. Let's take a quick break there, if we can, Clive, and ask viewers to join us on the other side, where we'll explore how the Luddites' experience might provide lessons for our own. Welcome back to Wide Angle. I'm Peter Bermudez, talking today with journalist Clive Thompson about the approaching wave of automation and the Luddites, the 19th century iteration of the Occupy movement. So let's make a shift, yeah, if we can, moving from the history of the first half of the show of the Luddites, their experience, early 19th century Northern Britain, and see how that connects to our own time. We are not dealing today with the stocking frame that the Luddites were 200 years ago, but you contend what we're dealing with is automation, yeah? That robots will be the means by which many people, closing in on 50% of people, will be displaced from the jobs that they're doing today over the course of the next decade or two, yeah? Tell us more. What's in store for us if we continue to travel this path?
Well, right now there's two big trends that are threatening an awful lot of jobs, and that is, as you mentioned, robotics, the ability of robots to physically move things around, to pilot cars, to packages from place to place. The second one is artificial intelligence, which is the increasing ability of computers to do cognitive work that used to seem like something that only humans could do. Recognizing things visually, recognizing patterns, writing. There's been a bunch of analysis done that has said that, you know, you put these two trends together. And the funny thing is, in the old days, it used to be that, you know, a robot would maybe, you know, take away the job of someone who's tightening a bolt on a car, physical labor. But now, there's a lot of mechanization that is taking away sort of classic white-collar work, right? So legal basic research is getting increasingly done by AI. There's essentially a lot of law bots now that can sort of fill out a lot of forms and do a lot of stuff that paralegals used to do. So you're seeing law hiring flattening. Wow. And that's not an area that you normally think of when you think of robotization, but you get things like that, you know. As self-driving cars come along, you know, they're already Uber bought a company that is working on self-driving 16-wheeler rigs. Now, you're talking about, if you talk about, you know, the trucking and shipping industry, that's like, you know, north of 1 million people in the U.S. With salaries that are in the high five to low six figures. So, you know, these are super great middle-class jobs that over the next 20 years we could start to see, you know, tail off to vanish really quickly.
In gathering material for the article you wrote for Smithsonian, you certainly spoke to a number of historians, I gather. This is obviously a monumental shift that we're going to be weathering. Yeah.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if they have a sense of what the likelihood is of maybe a latter-day Luddite rebellion. What's the likelihood that people, given so many people affected in such significant ways, what is the likelihood of people collaborating against what they perceive as the origin of this massive shift?
That's a great question, and I did ask exactly that to all the historians. I said, look, you know, what do you see? Do you see anything in today's environment that looks like the past? And most of them said, here's the thing. It's harder to mount that type of insurrection. Because people work in more disparate ways. The Luddites were all clustered in one physical place, so it was easy to get together, network, to share ideas, and they kind of had a choke point. You know, it would be a little harder to say, you know, how do you rebel against automated car driving, you know, when drivers are distributed everywhere across the country. It's the same reason it's harder to have, like, kind of a general strike. So in one sense, they say no. You're not going to see a Luddite-type uprising because it's simply harder to do. But you know, you do see all sorts of sort of things that remind you a little bit of the arguments about fairness and morality in capitalism. Like, you think even of something like Occupy Wall Street, which, you know, was an attempt by a lot of people to sort of grab society by the collar and say, pay attention to the fact that, you know, the same thing that the Luddites talked about, which is that more and more of the money and the profits were going to go to the people that own the machines. Well, you know, when you're talking about virtual machines, they're in fewer and fewer hands these days. So you can have a high-tech company that really employs maybe 1,000 or 2,000 people, but, you know, might eradicate millions of jobs and take all their profit for themselves. So Occupy Wall Street was, in a weird way, a little bit like the Luddites, but it's a lot harder to, I mean, how would you break machines today, right? You know, I asked this to friends, they said, well, you know, maybe it would be one of these attacks on a server, like a denial of service attack, a hacking attack almost like what maybe like Anonymous does or something like that. You know, that's, if you were to see a Luddite uprising, it would be like that. It would be saying, we're going to shut down Uber for a day. We're going to shut down Google so no one can do searches. We're going to shut down Amazon's website so no one can buy stuff from their flying robot drones. Mm-hmm. That would be probably what a modern Luddite uprising might look like, in addition to maybe, you know, swarming in the streets. But it's hard to say. Most of them were not super hopeful that we would see something like that. They thought it was not terribly likely.
Interesting. And I suppose it would be other activities they're already undergoing, like a fight for 15 or a living wage, or unionizing, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. Or the guaranteed annual income, which is the other thing that people would talk about. Well, if you're going to have a situation where people are rapidly thrown out of work, where an industry that sort of has existed for decades is gone in a matter of years, you might want to have a basic income below which no one can sink, so that if it's going to take 10 years for someone to effectively find a new thing to do, you don't want them just to fall completely off the, and you know. There's, you know, like once you start getting into thinking about what the policies might be that could help with the transition, you know, there's a lot of different, and now you're in the realm where a lot of economists and policymakers are thinking about what we should do about this. I did talk to some economists, and, you know, there are several camps. You know, there are some that say, look, you know, really, if you wanted to have a kind of a resilient society that was more able to weather these shocks, you frankly need to have something that is closer to like almost like a European approach to providing the basics. So that could be guaranteed income. That could be like nationalized healthcare, so that you actually can, if you don't have a job for a while, you're kind of okay on the health insurance front. That could be much cheaper higher education. If you're going to have a situation where you want people to be flexible in a knowledge economy, well, they should be as educated as they can be. If that's going to cost you 80 or 90 grand or 100 grand, that's not very viable. You'd want to literally wipe the slate clean and start with really, really much less expensive education. Yeah. So there are people that say, you know, we could do this, but man, it would take a lot of restructuring that isn't at all like what America looks like right now, and there may not be political will to do that, right?
You frame the coming world in terms of, it is cold comfort for those people caught in the middle, in this transition.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm glad to hear that there's some reevaluation, and not necessarily simply accepting automation as an inevitable. My concern is that it puts business, and I suppose stockholders to some degree, in the driver's seat, and the workers are secondary, and they're put into the equation only insofar as they further the ends of business. And to me, the Luddites were talking about a lost social contract.
Yeah, that's right.
An understanding. Right. And I think the understanding had been that business survives with people, and not necessarily the other way around. And it's heartening, and I hope that we think deeper about whether or not going down 50%, a displacement of jobs.
Really, I mean, some of those projections are very significant. And I mean, you know, frankly, I would say, when I think of who I've talked to about this issue, the people who seem to have a better grasp of stakes are, I would say, oddly, the certainly the people who are going to be displaced, I think they see what's coming. You talk to drivers, they know about all the stuff. You talk to lawyers. The high-tech CEOs, you know, also actually seem to get that this is an issue. Like, I mean, I was at a retreat where a bunch of high-tech CEOs were at, and literally, you know, they could sort of pick what sessions they wanted to go to, and like half of them were proposing things related to guaranteed annual income, because they were like, we understand the world that's coming, we see it coming, we know how fast it's coming, and oh my God, it's going to be just a nightmare if we don't get something like this in place. Like, they don't know the answer, but they see that. The people who I'm really worried about are the political classes, who, like, seem extraordinarily stuck in ideas and policies that might have been up to the challenge 20 or 30 years ago, but are not today.
Are there any resources, websites, organizations that are talking about this? I mean, from a historical standpoint, you name in your article Kirkpatrick Sales' Rebels Against the Future.
Fantastic book, yeah.
Is there anything else, either from a historical sort of Luddite perspective or to understanding the coming wave of automation and how we might sort of respond to it? Any resources for us in that respect?
Yeah. I mean, there have been a number of books that have been sort of grappling with this to a lesser. I mean, Tyler Cowen's book, Averages Over, sort of tries to think a little bit about clear-headedly what's going to happen. I'm serially mispronounce their names, but McAfee and I'm blanking on mispronouncing his last name at MIT. They did Race Against the Machine, which was an attempt to think through the consequences of how those work. There's books like that that are trying to think a little bit about this today. I definitely think that Kirkpatrick Sales' book is worth going to your local library. And you're going to have to go to the library, folks, because it's not easy to get your hands on anymore.
Well, and dare I say, Amazon. It may be delivered by a drone, but there are copies.
There are copies
at Amazon. Yeah,
it's still an amazing book, and I would love to see it reissued and updated for the modern day, because he could really see it. He could really see this stuff coming long before I think anyone else understood what's going on.
Clive, I want to thank you for taking the time to speak with me today, and thank you also for the wonderful article in Smithsonian.
I'm glad you liked it. It was a lot of fun to write.
Yeah. I hope we get a chance to talk again soon.
I'm sure we will. Take care.
Although our times may incline us to disparage them as uneducated laborers who blindly took aim at inanimate objects, the Luddites understood the tectonic shifts rumbling beneath them, grasped the economic forces moving about them. For those reasons, we would do well to remember their story. Yes, our times are more complicated than theirs, but the essentials remain regrettably similar, and our need for stories and heroes, or at least working models, grows all the more pressing. To that end, the Luddites extend to us across two centuries the hand of camaraderie, raise a call to action, and illuminate a path to follow. Pray we lend them an ear. On behalf of Clive Thompson, I'm Peter Bermudez. Thank you for joining us for this edition of Wide Angle.